to thank our sponsors. So I would like to thank Bosch, iRobot, Qualcomm, Disney, and Spaybar for their generous support. Also, I would like to thank USC for sponsoring and hosting the event, as well as helping with a lot of logistics. In terms of numbers, we sent out a call for registration to more than 15 companies in the area, in the SoCal area, and as well as more than 20 startups. We sent out a call for registration to 17 schools in the area, which included more than 100 academic labs, either working directly on robotics or working on technologies that are enabling inevitables for robotics. We have an amazing lineup of speakers, six speakers from academia, five from industry, and four from government and research labs. We have had more than 300 registrations, so you can see the curve there. We had a peak when we first announced the event, and we had a peak also yesterday. So actually it was going like a few people per day, and then 75 people yesterday. And so we have a little challenge with the launching of so, but we have a very good balance in our audience. About, actually, yesterday 30% has changed, 30-35% from industry, 60-65% from academia. And it spans more than 25 companies and 16 different schools. So it just shows how many different institutions we have in SoCal working on robotics. And also we have 23 people coming out of SoCal area, including states like Arizona, New York, Northern California, as well as people from outside the US, Canada, Colombia, and Italy. So five people from those. And we have accepted 25 posters, almost 50% acceptance rates. And we have 15 exhibition booths with potential live robotic demos from both academic labs and industry. Schedule-wise, this is how it looks like. We are going to have four technical sessions, and it's just a pretty packed schedule. Each talk is going to be 15 minutes, so we'll mainly take questions during the breaks, and we have a few long breaks during the event, so there will be enough time to interact with speakers. We are going to have poster session after lunch, just behind the curtain in the same hall, and at the evening we are going to have reception and exhibitions with potential live things. If you need any help with logistics, in addition to organizers, you can find Christina Fong. She was a tremendous help with all logistics in the last few months. We also have some fantastic student volunteers. Stephen and Sherry helped us with almost a lot of everything, including website design, registration. Also, I would like to thank our advisory committee, for Jordan Beach for all the guidance during the last few months. So some basic information in terms of Wi-Fi, just connect to guest network, USC guest network, no password. And that's all I have. With that, I would like to hand it over to Coral to tell you a little bit about venue and robotics at USC. Let's thank you.
Welcome to all of you. I'm just going to take a couple of minutes to welcome you all specifically to USC. We're very happy that you're all here. And we hope that this becomes an annual tradition where other institutions in the area pick up the baton and volunteer to host this event on an annual basis. So at USC, we have a bunch of roboticists. We are very excited about all the things we do in robotics at USC. I'm especially proud of the fact that several of our students and postdocs are going to show off some of their work today. We have some booths and some demos and some posters, so please engage with them. There's a huge diversity of sort of work at USC, not all of which really should be flickering like this.
Shaking the world.
We are shaking the world. this does not work well. I hope the next week we'll have better luck. But in any case, there are two things I wanted to say. In addition to all the wonderful research laboratories we have at USC, we're also very proud of the fact that USC has developed a very significant outreach effort in robotics. As part of National Robotics Week, which just concluded, we had a giant robotics open house in USC. Several thousand school children came by. And it was really fun to see how much robotics has taken over the imagination of the public and how significant a role it's playing in education today. There are a couple of new centers at USC. I wanted to highlight one connected to robotics. S.K. Gupta is leading a new center for advanced manufacturing here at USC. It's a Southern California node of a DOE-sponsored Institute of Robotic Manufacturing. And we have a new state-of-the-art facility for this, which is just a few blocks from campus. We're running a little short of time, so I'm going to run through all the labs we have here. Please visit our demos and posters and get to know some of the info we're going to see. And so I think what remains for me is to introduce our first speaker. Our first speaker in the first session is Professor Dennis Hong from UCLA, where he heads the Romanda Lab. Dennis is an expert in building robots, which are remarkable for their mechanics and their clever design. He's one of the leading people in the world who's pioneered the design of several very different mechanisms, all geared towards doing tasks that most of us would find incredibly challenging. So, pushing the boundaries of physical robot design, Dennis Hong.
Okay, good morning. Thanks for having me. My name is Dennis Hong. I'm a professor at the Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering Department at UCLA and the director of Romella, the Robotics and Mechanism Laboratory, also at UCLA. In our lab, we do a lot of things. Actually, I started my career by doing autonomous vehicles. In 2007, everybody remembers the DARPA Urban Challenge. Everybody remembers the first place and second place were the third place winners. chemically actuated robot, wheel-leg, hybrid robot, climbing, rolling robots, all different type of mechanisms and interesting things. Humanoid robots, and probably some of you know about the car for the blind that we also developed. So we do a lot of interesting things. However, today I would like to start with humanoid robots. We've been working with humanoid robots for the past decade. We create many robots. Many of you probably have Darwin OP that was created, sponsored by NSF. It's a fully open source robot. Charlie is also very well known. Thor Ardy, we use this for the DARPA Robotics Challenge. Sapphire sponsored by the Navy. This is a Thor that uses Series Elastic Actuator and many other robots, Thor OP, Arpius that we're working on, Darwin, HP, Mini Hugo, and many, many more. Now, of course, humanoid robots are cool, and we do have a need for humanoid robots because if you want to have robots living with us in this environment was designed for humans. There are stairs, there's a door handle. It's designed for humans, so unless the robot is a human shape and size, it won't be able to navigate this environment and use all the tools designed for humans. That's why we've been using humanoid robots. However, as you probably know, these type of humanoid robots are very slow. And they always fall down. They're so unstable. They're too expensive, they're complicated, and even if they solve all these problems, they're gonna be too expensive. And too unsafe, and it had a lot of problems. So I've been trying to pondering the problem. We do need these type of mobility robots, but walking with 2 feet is so difficult. Now there's a lot of other experts in bipedal robots, and you know, trying to explain why walking with 2 feet is easy to talk to an engineer, but if you want to talk to a kid, why does your robot always fall down? I try to explain it's very difficult. So I've been trying to think, if I cannot explain why this is difficult to a kid, that means we truly do not understand it. So I've been you know, thinking about this problem over and over again. And one thing that I found is this. This is fascinating. Check this out. So one of the reasons why making robots walk with 2 feet is so difficult is because the distance between the left and right leg. You have the left leg and right leg. The legs move forward and backward, up and down. Mass is moving distance. So we have a unwanted, you know, oscillating movement this way, oscillating movement this way. So that's why your robot walks like this and falls down. So the distance between left and right leg is a problem. Now, and some probably you guys are familiar with this. This is a very popular robotics company called Robo One Competition. So if you look at these robots, these are robots built by, you know, hobbyists, not really researchers, but they're agile, they walk fast. And I was amazed, how do you do this? And if you look carefully, they always walk sideways, right? Because if you walk sideways, something interesting happens. If you walk sideways, your left and right leg, they align, right? So you don't get rid of that distance, so you don't have that unwanted moments this way or that way. If you actually look at people, you know, fencing or ballerinas, they always do it sideways, and maybe that's the reason. So why not make the robot just walk sideways, right? That's also a problem. But if you do this, the problem is you're not really using your knees if you walk, they line up, but you're not really using your knees. So I was thinking about this. Okay, then why not do this? We move the legs like this. Okay. Now if we do this, let's make this forward and make it walk forward like that. Okay, so now it's walking like this. Let's make more changes. If you walk like this, you really don't need your feet or your ankles anymore. So I get rid of your feet and get rid of the ankles. That's altogether 4 to use our feet. If you're gonna make changes, let's make more changes. I'm gonna change the shin. And also I'm gonna change the head. I'm gonna talk about why are you doing these. So I'm very excited to announce you and show you the robot called Naviros, or Navi. It stands for Non-Anthropomorphic Biped Robot System, or Navi as a non-anthropomorphic biped. So as the name says, it's a biped robot, but it does not look anything like a human. So how does it walk? This is a dynamic simulation animation. So it's so easy, it just walks like that. As a matter of fact, we bought a bunch of robots today. Over there you can see it. We're going to show a demonstration of this walking and jumping and doing a lot of crazy things. Now, one of the projects that we worked on before, sponsored by the Navy, was a robot called Sapphire, Shipboard Autonomous Firefighting Robot. This was a firefighting robot, humanoid robot for Navy ships. Now, one of the problems that we had is once you open this door, if you've been on a Navy ship, they have a really high door seal, so we had to brace and do all this stuff. It was crazy difficult. But if you lose the constraint that your robot needs to be actually like human morphologies, then you can do clever things like this. We made the knee rotate 360 degrees. So we go over like this. Is this cool? With a clever design twist, we can solve a lot of problems that we're trying to solve these days in different ways. What about stairs? Our robots do climb stairs, but now it's easy. We can do something like that, right? Actually, there's a lot of problems to really implement it, but gives you the idea. So is it just simulation and animation? No. Just in 2 weeks, from idea to design to building and testing and coding, I mean, in just 2 weeks, our first robot prototype was born, and you'll be surprised, you haven't seen anything like this before. Right, it walks dynamically, right?
You're wild.
It also can jump, I'll talk more about this if we have time, but it doesn't use series last actuators, but it uses compliant feet. So it can jump, right? And it's happy to see you. I'll try to show it in motion by motion, right? So you can go on the same. The cool thing is that every video that you see, okay, this is currently open loop. It even doesn't have, this version doesn't even have an eye in you. Everything is an open loop. So this robot, the height is about 1.35 meters. This is the first prototype. It's very lightweight, 4 kilograms. But note that it's tethered off-board power and alpha electrics right now. 2 degrees of freedom per leg, and has compliant feet, which is also a very key feature. So normally it walks like this. This is how it normally walks. And you can also do a big step walk. It's like, stomping like, oh, I'm Godzilla, I'm gonna walk over this. You can also do an energy efficient walk. So again, we don't have a lot of time, but before our approach was to try to come with compliant actuators. We worked a lot of series elastic actuators, and we have a new actuator we brought in here. We're going to show you a demonstration of jumping. But those are still a long way to go, and they're very expensive and complicated. To make a really lightweight, simple, low-cost robot, we've been thinking, what really important is for the robot when it interacts with the outside environment? If you have the compliance over there, it might be good enough. So in this case, all the joints are simple position control servos, but the foot is compliant. So we can have a lot of these good characteristics that we normally have in one action. So you can put it, let's just put down, it absorbs the energy, and then the next step it releases it. So this is a very energy efficient walk. So we have many, many different types of gates. It also can jump because you have compliant feet. Okay, this is the early test version. We have even, currently it jumps about this high. I'll show you today in the back, but the back in the demo. And we do a lot of things. It's a happy robot, right? Alright, so also you can walk on uneven terrain again. This is a simple, it's a feasibility study to see. Everything is open, it doesn't even have a vision system. You just put a bunch of panels, you can walk over that, you can walk uphill, downhill, and all those kind of things. So the next version that we're working on does have feedback, and we're going to do a demonstration later this year. We want to do a demonstration of a robot actually package delivery. So there's going to be an auto, this is just showing our idea. Autonomous vehicle is going to come, the trunk pops open, and this robot walks. This is outside, this Ford, right? Walks forward, and the head opens up, and it picks up a package and puts it in the head. And then it walks onto the sidewalk. By the way, this one has four limbs, not two legs and two arms, but four limbs. It can also have the jumping gait, jumps around, very happily jumps around. And then we have a new one called a scrambling walk. That can walk on uneven terrain. Basically, it's a reactive control way of making it walk on uneven terrain. And then it's going to climb a step, and then go to a building, push a button, and then, again, it lifts its arm, then it becomes like a humanoid robot. This is important because the hallway is very narrow, so two people can walk through. And then at the end, it's going to deliver the packet. So we're going to do a demonstration of this this year. So that's our plan. All right, so as I mentioned, we've been trying to figure out how to make robots walk stably, low-cost, safe, and fast. So we came up with another robot. This one is called Baloo, stands for Buoyancy Assisted Lightweight Leg Unit. So the pictures that you see over here, these are the things that inspired us to come up with this crazy idea. An astronaut on the moon, walking, jumping like this. If you see Wall-E and the movie in space, he uses a fire extinguisher to action reaction and float around. Sick Bug. Another animation, Pixar animation, up, there's a house and a bunch of balloons that float around. In a clip, there's a mountain goat stuck on the mountain goat. A diver with a bunch of weights walking on the water, a flamingo, and humanoid robot. So these type of pictures and images inspired us to come up with this crazy idea. So before I show you this thing, we come up with all of our really crazy creative ideas, and one way to do it is to ask ourselves crazy questions. Many times if I ask ourselves crazy questions, crazy answers come out, and sometimes the crazy answers lead to really creative ideas. So once we ask ourselves, what if we could change the direction of gravity? Doesn't make sense. How can you change the direction of gravity? But once you ask that question, we came up with this idea. Let me show you a quick video of this. That's my son, by the way. So it's a robot that the body is a helium balloon. So this is a robot that literally cannot fall down. It's a very simple robot. It can walk forward, backwards, sideways, can climb upstairs, downstairs. But interesting thing is, only with 2 degrees of freedom can walk forward, backwards, sideways, and turn. Only with 2 degrees of freedom. At this point, everything is open, the person is controlling it, so it doesn't have any sensors at this point. It's a dynamic simulation. It walks very well. We brought it here today, by the way. And it's very safe. A baby can crawl in front of it without any problem. It can go over obstacles. It can jump around. It can jump on, not this side, but it can jump on, obstacles like on chairs. It's trying to get its foot over that. And now trying to do both feet go over that obstacle over there. It can walk up downstairs. Oh, it's a good dancer too. It likes to dance. I'm gonna do crazy stuff. You haven't seen any robot doing something like that. However, it does have its own problems, but you cannot make it work efficiently outdoors because if the wind blows, it blows away. I'm gonna show you some quick things. These are things that we're currently working on. I'm not gonna talk too much about it, but we're doing really crazy stuff with this new system. And also, it can literally walk on water. One version has ping pong balls with a fin, can walk on water. You can make it walk on a tightrope, which is actually very, very easy to do. So this is a robot called Baloo, and you wanna show the video, the last thing, something cool. And it has like this. Thank you very much, I think we're out of time. Idea. So these are just a small portion of all the new creative things that we do. One really important thing in my lab, Romella, I think it's you have to have a really fun environment. When you're having fun, that's when the creative energy flows. I want to show you a quick video in our lab. This is, I think this was like Saturday night, and this is what we do. I'll show you some robots I haven't shown you yet. So you've seen Baloo dancing. So while doing this, let's bring on our other robots. So you've seen Nadir Nadiros. He has a famous move. Look at his foot. He does a foot shaking a bit. He's like, shaking.
No, so we'll defer questions to the break. Thank you so much, Dennis.
Thank you so much, yeah.
I'd like to invite our next speaker to plug in. So David Rankinsmeyer joins us from the CRI. So David is an expert in neuromuscular control, in rehabilitation robotics in particular, and he's going to tell us about some of the new advances from his lab. So thanks, David.
Okay, well thanks very much for inviting me. Thanks especially to Solmaz Kia, who's a valued new colleague at UC Irvine Robotics. And gosh, with the dance video, I don't know what to do, but I can't say one of our robots is in the music video with Dr. Dre and Eminem, I Need a Doctor. So if you want more dance videos, you can go to that one and you can see one of our gay robots giving Dr. Grace and rehabilitation. But what I'm going to talk about is rehabilitation. Some of the things I'm going to talk about are, I have a financial interest in, so I'm going to let you know that. And a lot of this work has been supported by a center at the Rehabilitation Institute of Chicago, now called the Shirley Ryan Ability Institute. And it's called the Machines Assisting Return to Society. That's, and I could direct that, which doesn't happen. And the problem that we've been trying to solve is, how do we help people who have had a stroke, an injury to the brain, through a blood vessel getting clogged or broken, recover? And so here's someone, one of our volunteers in our lab, who I'm asking you to raise your arm and touch your chin. you can see it's very difficult for it to do. And so people, a lot of times, will just stop using the limb after stroke. And this contributes, it's the leading cause of disability. 1 in 6 people worldwide are going to have a stroke. About all of us will spend about 20% of our life disabled. So there's really not enough repetition or practice in conventional rehabilitation therapy. People have actually quantified this. And it's kind of one-on-one therapy with an occupational therapist or physical therapist. You might only do 30 repetitions per session. We know from motor learning studies and animal studies, at least in order of magnitude more. And I put this up quickly when Dennis was talking about walking, a sideways walking, because I love this. This is someone videoed a kid learning to walk. And so in rehabilitation, the typical paradigm is to relearn to walk, you just walk straight down the hallway. Get on a treadmill, walk straight, and all the initial rehab robots, a lot of the exoskeletons are really focused on that sort of straight ahead walking. Well, when you look at a little kid who's learning to walk, they wander, they go sideways a lot, and they fall a lot. So they fell 17 times an hour, they take about 5 million steps over the course of that learning. So we are orders of magnitude away from having rehabilitation training that looks like that. So it's an exciting time. Now, some questions. You know, there's a talk in the afternoon I'm really looking forward to where really hard problems in robotics. A really hard problem in robotics is how do you provoke the nervous system to recover? How can you use an external mechanical environment to provide assistance or air augmentation or and motivation in order to help a person recover? What a lot of people did is build robots that can assist. So this is one of the exoskeletons we built at UCI with Jim Barbaro. And this is just kind of showing here the student is just relaxed and is kind of showing the capability of the robot. It's pneumatic, has a sort of interesting parallel design. So a lot of people built this. Rehabilitation robotics, about 20 years ago, it was pretty much stalled. The whole focus had been on making, say, wheelchair-mounted robots or personal aids that could help people who are paralyzed do things. And it was basically a fail, and it's still basically a fail. So there's and that's now kind of going through a reemergence. So, but what happened was several groups started working, a group at MIT, my group at Berkeley, and then a group at Stanford, one in Switzerland, at ETH, started working on robots that could assist in therapy. And you can see the field just exploded, up to about 1,000 publications a year, mainly on robots that can provide physical therapy. So what does that look like? So here's the Bones robot actually giving helping someone to retrain after a stroke. This person, he used to drive a motorcycle before a stroke. Here he's driving a simulation of a motorcycle through Death Valley, and he has to extend his wrist with the robot. And the robot's very soft, and it has to learn a model of how much assistance the person needs in order to successfully complete the task. And you can see he's quite engaged and quite motivated with this because he's able to achieve something that's extremely functional in this virtual environment. So now there's been many clinical trials of robot therapy. Here's a typical result from a device in our lab called T-Rex, working with Three Parmon out in Delaware with an arm support that was really just a spring-based arm support with a grip sensor that could detect trace amounts of grip force and then a virtual reality environment. We compared it to conventional tabletop exercise. And I'm showing on the right here the Fugelmeier score. That goes from 0 to 66. 0 mean complete paralysis, 66 normal arm movement. A therapist watches you do 33 test movements and then rates it 0, 1, or 2. And you can see the red is the robot group, and people who did this training for 2 months with the exoskeleton actually recovered better at a 6-month follow-up. So, and that's a typical result. So these robots that assist people, it's done well, you get an incremental improvement that people appreciate over conventional therapy. And so now, that was good enough. This is a commercial product. It's sold by Herkimer. It's called Armeo Spring. It's a $60,000 device. It's in about 1,000 centers and helping spinal cord injury, cerebral palsy, stroke, humeral fracture, multiple sclerosis. So I'm going to get scientific here. Why are robots that assist beneficial? So we built a robot with Eric Wolbrecht at the University of Idaho to answer this question. So we thought maybe robots that assist are beneficial because they promote hepatic plasticity. And if that's true, then we wanted to look at the finger and the hand because it's highly sensitive, has a large cortical representation. So we made a robot. It can assist, and you play a version of Guitar Hero to keep people super engaged. They're the most popular video game ever invented. And we broke people up into two groups. One got high robot assistance, and one got low robot assistance. They each did 8,000 movements, so we matched the dose. So one thing about robots that assist is often they help people do more therapy, more movements. And so we didn't want that. We wanted to say what intrinsic to the assistance helps people. And so we get some, now we break people, randomize them into two groups. One gets 85% of success in playing Guitar Hero, and one gets 50% success. If you turn the robot off, the both groups are down around 20%. So extremely frustrating to play the game. And we see in the Spiegelmeyer score the same thing. The highest assist group benefits more at the long-term follow-up. And then we see that people who are more severely impaired, so lower baseline Spiegelmeyer, at the long-term follow-up with the high assist tend to benefit more from it. So there's something about the assist that's better for more impaired people. Now, our key hypothesis in the study was if there's a heavy learning going on, in the sense that what the robot is doing is, you know, I'm willing to movement. Normally, I can't move very well, so I don't get very much sensory feedback about the movement. But the robot, if it helps me move better, I get better sensory input that's correlated with my efferent activity. And so if that's true, you would need intact proprioceptive pathways, proprioception, your sense of limb position in space. So we use the robot to have move people's fingers past each other like this, and then ask them to push a button when the fingers were overlapping, a new proprioceptive test. And what you can see here is a very exciting result, I think, which is that people who made large proprioceptive errors at baseline, this is before they did the therapy, they did not benefit at all from the therapy. So if you don't have those sensory channels intact, you can't benefit from the assistance. But people who had intact properception benefited two times more than the average. So we have a strong proprioceptive effect that supports the Hebbian hypothesis. But we also have this interesting effect about when you interact with a robot that's helping you succeed, you become more highly motivated to engage in therapy. So this is a scale called the intrinsic motivation inventory. And you can see the group that's getting the high assist is much more motivated. And they actually, on another scale, say that they're putting more effort into the therapy, even because they're having more success, which is the robot helping. Helping them. So why are robots that assist beneficial for rehabilitation after stroke? They can increase the amount of practice fundamentally, they can help you do more reps. But even when we control for the amount of repetitions, they stimulate plasticity through what appears to be a heavy mechanism that depends on proprioception. They increase motivation for therapy, probably it's related to reinforcement learning systems, dopaminergic systems, which better cement motor learning. And these features seem particularly important for people who are more severely impaired. So there's one big caveat. So we found also in our studies that we have robots that form models of people to see how much they should help, that people would automatically let the robot take over. So if you use a standard sort of adapting sliding mode controller to form a model of the forces that you need to assist the person, your nervous system, everyone in here has an algorithm they're implementing every moment to try to decrease your effort. Okay, it's an optimization mechanism that we call slacking, and it's a very, you can mathematically model it. And so the big caveat is robots, assistive robots that do too much don't work. And so what you need is anti-slacking robots. You need robots that allow some level of error. So then just to finish up, two minutes probably? Yeah. So where is rehabilitation robotics headed? So we're now seeing customized robotic therapy based on computational modeling. Neuroplasticity and motor learning. We're seeing a lot of wearable robotics. Probably everyone in here has seen the maybe 10 or 20 companies that are now making legged exoskeletons to try to replace wheelchairs or provide a therapeutic function. And so we're seeing this combination now of assistive and therapeutic functions into some of the robots. And then robots are shedding actuators. So these robotic therapy devices are shedding actuators. So I'll show you a few kind of wearable devices that can provide intensive therapy. This is called the Music Love. Nissan Friedman invented this for his part of his PhD. He played Guitar Hero. It's a glove. It's a better design now. It uses conductive fabric. So we commercialized this. This is in use by about 1,000 people so far, and you can buy it on Amazon. The cool thing about this type of therapy, you give it to people to take home, you tell them to do a certain amount of therapy. The first week they did what we told them. Weeks 2 and 3 they did more. Triple. So you get the third most popular video game franchise in history. A simple game that's amazingly engaging. How do you get more repetitions for people who are this impaired? So what we've discovered is using what I call Stonehenge technology, is that if you put levers on wheelchairs and take away the requirement to actually grip the push rim, then people with this extremely high level of impairment can still propel themselves around. So we think this is going to be the type of wheelchair that eventually every stroke patient will use when they're in the hospital to ambulate to their therapy appointments. And in so doing, they'll get hundreds of practice movements with their impaired arm in a functionally meaningful way. And then the last thing I want to show you is called the manometer, which I'm not getting. Let's see that. Anyway, so this is a this wristband has magnetometers in it. You wear a ring that's a magnet. We call it a Fitbit for the fingers. So people after stroke stop using their limb. We can detect the amount of finger movement through the system as the magnetic field changes orientation. And then we can give feedback to the person about if you're not using your hand for half an hour, sort of like your Fitbit, how many steps you're taking with your hand. So I think that's it. Thank you. Fun video. I teach a class, a junior level mechanical systems laboratory class where we build robotic devices out of competition. This is a little bit of a takeoff of something for BPFL that they saw. These are little air-powered robots. They build a single-stroke engine or a leg that pushes, and very good. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, David.